am your host, Owen Schroyer, and I am now joined by Dr. Steve Pachinik. And I actually got to tell you, Steve, you know, normally we get into the geopolitics and international events and ongoings, but today I was actually wanting to do another stock segment with you. Are you interested in talking some stock market with me?
Sure, if you're interested, why not?
Well, I'm very interested because what I'm noticing is a trend in the stock market right now of major, major swings. Now, we're talking swings of hundreds of points, positive, negative. And if you're a day trader, I would imagine it's a very hectic environment to be in right now. But when you see these trends, I just had to tell you, something that comes to my mind is A, an opportunity to make a bunch of money, but B, also an opportunity to lose a bunch of money, and then how there could easily be people within the system manipulating that. I mean, what do these huge swings mean to you where the stock market is going up 500, down 500, up? I mean, it's so volatile right now.
Part of it is the uncertainty of the interest rate increase. We knew, remember when I said to you, the stock market is really 6 months ahead of where we are today. And what happens is often the stock market will either anticipate the increase in rates, interest rates, or it will react more immediately. This stock market reacted very quickly to the fact that the interest rates were increased and a lot of the stocks pulled back. Some of the major ones, the value stocks, people can't go wrong if they go into the big stocks where, you know, we call them pension widows and pensioners. That's not going to be a problem because there'll always be a dividend. The problem becomes for guys like myself and day traders where we have to work off of the volatility. But in my particular case, what I look at is cybersecurity or quantum encryption and other elements of the new world that's arising very, very quickly. And the stock market is a very good indicator for it because, for example, a stock that I invest in, SAIL, which is a quantum encryption capacity stock, it's going up while the markets are going down. So in effect, the sophisticated trader who's looking at the daytime trades and somewhat out to the future, let's say the more immediate future, we're going into quantum encryption, we're going into quantum computers, we're going into things like PFPT and other elements which are not the mainstream of stock market thinking. And in fact, what's really happening is you and Alex are really anticipating the future world of content. And as you guys have gone quantum in leaps in terms of content delivery, so has the computer. And this is something that's not been brought to the forefront because most of the people look at the New York Times or some other daily newspaper, which is way, way behind what's going on. So from a day trader point of view, it's very tough. You have to be able to absorb a lot of losses and then be able to hold on and understand where you turn around and you kind of you swing around the market and you get into the more volatile stocks that you think have an upside to it. And for me, that tends to be in cybersecurity, quantum encryption, and those kind of things.
And those seem like they're good, you know, buys right now because it's still kind of probably low. You don't have
Correct.
To buy in high where you'd be looking at a stock like Boeing or Lockheed or Raytheon where it's going to consistently deliver in the long term, but it's tougher to get in to make that return. Whereas with some of these new technologies, quantum computing, cybersecurity, one I didn't hear you mention, but I think would be right up there, if not perhaps above all of them, artificial intelligence for long term. You can get into these markets now before it gets too expensive.
Owen, you just hit it on the head. I just invested in quantum computing, which is D-wave computation, and that's exactly correct because it's a one- or two-digit stock value, and it's worth it. If you go into Google or you're going into the FANGs, you really have to be able to have major movements that are not significant to a day trader like me. Even if you make 100 points or 200, it's really not relevant to the fact that you've got five, six digits there, as opposed to, let's say, quantum computing, where you have D-wave integration, which is a sophisticated way of saying analyzing code and analyzing quantum encryption. Now you have a company that does quantum encryption. Actually, you pick the right one. And that's what I invested in today in a big way. So you and I are on the same line. And I think those people who are interested in it, The PFPT went up, it went to 125, it's pulled back to 120, it'll pull back to 118. That's quantum encryption. But the quantum encryption code, the capability that you saw in this company with D-Wave encryption, and you have all other types of analytical capacity that we don't even talk about. That's the type of stocks where you get in at $5, $7, and they look like cheap stocks, which they are, but in fact, they are the future of our nation. And we're working at a very fast rate, as are the Chinese and the Europeans. So this is not an isolated case, but you picked up a very good point, Erwin.
Well, what would you say is the safest way to go about this with an emerging and advancing field like quantum computing, like artificial intelligence? Would you say, and perhaps it just depends on what you feel like doing, but would you say it's better to spread yourself thin throughout the market because you could hit any winner? Or would you say it's safer to pick a winner or maybe two and invest heavier in those stocks?
That's a very good question. In the beginning, if you really don't understand quantum theory and you don't understand the variations from D-Wave or quantum encryption or sophisticated encryption codes or the cloud, it's better to basically look at different companies. And if you want to kind of put your toe into the water and put a little bit on each one so you get a feeling of how they move and what they're about. But you constantly have to reassure yourself you understand what that stock company does as opposed to somebody else. So quantum computer and PFPT are not necessarily the same, but they may be in the same broad area. So that kind of approach, for me, makes some sense, but it means a lot of homework, Owen. It means you've got to really understand the different analytical tools, and I think you're approaching it the right way. ETF.
Well, that's the thing for me is, I mean, really, if you want to be successful doing this in the short term, you have to be on it, I mean, 24-7, especially right now. We're going to talk more about this and how news headlines, do they affect the stock market, and how can you profit off of a news trend? We'll be right back. My current guest, Dr. Steve Pachinik, we've been talking stocks and what to do if you're looking at certain markets and trying to make money in the long term, what to do if you're a day trader. And this headline ran today, Dr. Pachinik, at businessinsider.com. The Mueller Risk Index, the newest way for Wall Street to navigate how much to freak out about the Russia investigation. Now, while this story actually gets into some of the stuff that you're talking about as far as, you know, what stocks to go into, but with their stat cast, but this story is basically saying the stock market is reacting to every move, every story that comes out about the Mueller-Russia probe, to which I would respond, there's an inkling of truth to that in that the market responds to really any news trend and any headline that gets published, the market will have a reaction. So, A, do you agree with that? And then B, if that's true, how does the individual that wants to make money in the stock market take advantage of news trends?
That's a very good point. That particular article has really very little relevance to the market. They think the market has some influence, a reaction to the Mueller episode. Nobody really cares in the market. We're so used to Mueller or Comey or anybody hitting on the president. That's not relevant. But I'll give you an example of what is relevant. A stock which is called MDXG, that's the designation. It's a medical stock which provides tissues for rheumatoid arthritis, for wounds. It's really an excellent stock. Came out at the price of 16 at the IPO, had major earnings, and then some idiot came forth that night at the price of 16 and said that there was all kinds of corruption. The New York Times picked it up, and there was no corruption. And the stock went from 16 to 6. In a case like that, I hold it. And then I start buying in the thousands more of it. MDXG went up to 8. I started buying more, 8,000. Even though there was an ongoing investigation, presumably, all the law firms, which have nothing else to do, but they just create class action suits, which is a disturbance to the market. That's a greater problem. Despite the fact that there was that accusation in a newspaper, everybody who knew that stock and the value of the stock plus the transparency in the stock went up, and the stock keeps going up. And that's where the day traders are going to get into trouble if they watch the Muellers or they watch the news that's not significant, as opposed to the news which seems to be serious, like an investigation, but in fact you realize you have all of these prostitutes in the law firms, which really just create class action suits for no other reason that they try to make money. In the
let's recall fake news has done this to the overall stock market before too. Let's not forget, I think it was Brian Ross at ABC who reported something about an indictment on Trump or something. I forget what it was exactly. Stock market has a huge tank within the next hour. People thinking, I guess, there'd be some sort of chaos because Trump was going down or something. Turns out to be total fake news. But to get more specific to the point that you just brought up about the MDXD stock, how they have an investigation ongoing, people dump the stock, it then drops 10 points. It seems to me, long-term, that actually investigations into whatever company's stock you're holding is actually a good thing. It seems like it always turns out to be a good thing because you can actually take advantage of it.
You hit it on the head, Owen, but you're contrarian as I am, and the answer is very simple. It's true. You understand the dynamics. Basically, it's paradoxical. If, in fact, there's an investigation and you know that the transparency and the validity of the company is strong and you know the product is very strong because they're selling it everywhere and the earnings turn out to be 9 cents versus 4 cents, in 3 days they're going to announce that, then you know the value of that stock goes from 6 to 9 to 10 and 11. That's where you make the money. Where you have also pointed out an issue. For example, originally when Trump was saying negative things about North Korea, the Chinese companies were going under it, and I had to short them. But in the long run, when I really understood that Trump was quiet and started to kind of hint that he had an agreement with North Korea, this was about 7 to 8 months ago, I started buying into the Chinese stocks because I knew once that agreement would come through, and I believed Trump would do it. As I said about the Syria attack, it was really a signaling into North Korea. And basically, Trump and Pompeo and the CIA have done a great job in really trying to create something that has not been done in the past 30 or 40 years, and that's peace between North Korea and South Korea. Once that's accomplished, the markets will roar upwardly.
Well, and I think the meeting is set to take place in June, so I think we're going to have a lot happen in June after that meeting, because Trump is then going to have the media in his back pocket, and he can do anything, and it'll always be Trump by the fact he just got peace with North Korea. But since we're on that subject, and great talking stocks with you, it's actually refreshing to get away from the political numbness that we deal with nonstop here. But let's get back to it, actually, because this headline just went across the Drudge Report, and I'm sure it's going to make its waves. North Korea's nuclear test site has collapsed, and then, of course, Chinese media is saying that that's why Kim Jong-un suspended the tests and then made it out to look like detente with America, and then America bragging and Trump bragging as if they accomplished something, but really it's the site just collapsing. It wasn't working anyway. I would actually reason that these are probably two isolated incidents. I think North Korea is legitimate in their negotiations with Trump. However, their test site probably did collapse because they just weren't using it properly. They weren't taking care of the facilities. So what does this mean to you? What do you think this is? North Korea's nuclear test site has collapsed. Is that why North Korea made the deal, or is this just an isolated incident?
Really what it is, again, Owen, you go back to the narrative of what Trump always says. Create hyperbole. Create a storyline that's a distraction from the actual deal. The deal is the most important element of here. So what he's giving, he's allowing North Korea to save face, to say, look, whatever happened in the nuclear arms race, it fell or it fell apart. But this guy, Kim Jong-un, despite what I said in the beginning to really raise his heckles, I really think he's an honorable man. And he knows he's honorable because Kim Jong-un was trained in the West. He was not trained in Asia. He was trained in Switzerland, as I said, in Swiss boarding schools. So he understands America. He understands China. He understands that he wants business to come into North Korea. And that's his primary goal. And he's redefined his own position as the first person or the first president, the first lady, his wife. And in fact, what he's doing is realigning his own narrative to be commensurate with that of Trump's. So all of this story is just consistent with Trump's ultimate goal of making a peace deal. In the meantime, there will be all kinds of threats and side stories. But the real
It'll be the same, you know, merry-go-round, essentially, but the progress is still there. Do you think, kind of tongue-in-cheek, but, you know, based on what we're seeing right now, can Trump accomplish the same bromance with Kim Jong-un that he has with Macron?
It's a little bit different. With Macron, it's the opposite. Macron is trying very hard to be liked by daddy. In this case, daddy is turning around and said, I happen to like this guy, Kim Jong-un. He's my favorite son of all the sons. Macron, he can solicit my favors, and he can be sycophant, which the French are very good at doing, but I'm not really concerned with Macron. He can have a nice dinner, and he and his wife, lovely wife, can come
here. Did you hear his speech today?
No, because Macron's speech is going to be a reiteration of Reagan or someone else. Macron is a very clever bureaucrat. He's not really a man who's created his own assets.
So you're not buying. You're not buying Macron as being genuine with Trump.
No, he's basic. Trump understands him. He's a kid. He's a kid who's hustled his way up the socialist ladder in a bureaucracy in France. I know it very well. I mean, he was the designated heir. He looks good. His parents are very impressive, more than he is. Both his father and mother are physicians of a very high standard, including being professors. He's not really accomplished anything. He was a bureaucrat. He was in economics. He went to the Rothschild Bank to make himself a millionaire. Then he married his teacher when he was a young kid. She's 24 years older than he is. I'm sure she's a lovely lady. But that's not an impressive accomplishment. He's done very little for France. France is in a disarray again. What is really the breaking point for Trump is Kim Jong-un. When he looks at that, he is more important than even Xi Jinping of China. And in a way, the one who he has to be wary of is Xi Jinping of China, because he feels a little bit left out, as does Prime Minister Abe of Japan, who is coming back and running back to Trump every time to make sure that Japan is part of this deal. I suspect.
Yeah, and it was significant for Trump to invite France, for Trump to invite Macron to the official first state dinner. I mean, that was a significant event to happen. And I'm surprised. I hear you. I think Macron is probably a globalist bureaucrat puppet. But I thought his speech today was genuine. At least it seemed that way. It seemed heartfelt. His politics are still insane, obviously. His politics are whacked out as they get. But the speech felt heartfelt. But Dr. Steve Pachinik, he's the doctor. He says don't buy it. He's basically a puppet of the bureaucracies. Dr. Steve P., great to have you on as usual. Great advice with the stock markets, too.
Thank you all.
All right, doctor. We'll see you next time.